The arcade scene of another age, complete with what I assume was tracksuits, sticky floors and cigarette smoke, was something I missed out on completely thanks to my age. That doesn't mean I never played an arcade machine though, as they were still fairly common in cinemas and restaurants during my childhood. One such restaurant I went to as a child was called Jimmy Dean's. This was a 1950s themed joint that incidentally was full of cigarette smoke, tracksuits and sticky floors, but also had a Cruisin' USA arcade machine. I played this every time I went there, it's what I solely looked forward to on every visit. When I came across the N64 port, however, developed by Williams in 1996, I just had to give it a play. It was basically all that existed of arcade machine interaction during my childhood. Is the magic still there though? Well,
this game certainly stands out, that much I can say. You won't forget about it, not even during the birth of your firstborn, it'll still be in the back of your head. Cruisin' USA is about cruising the USA. The idea is that you start off on one side of the country and street race your four-sided polygonal death machine to the other. Really, there is nothing else to this game. It's a racing arcade game to the bone and does not introduce any varied mechanics at all. You choose a car, which all handle exactly the same, and then you're thrown right into a race. You can choose to cruise the US of A and do it properly, or pick a track straight up as they're classed by difficulty, or just let the game choose for you. So once you're off, you realize how incredibly weird the controls are. When I played the arcade machine I loved years ago, it of course used a steering wheel and pedals, but I felt that the developers didn't translate this well to an N64's controller. It's Z to accelerate, which is fairly normal, but it actually uses one of the back triggers to brake, which is what threw me off. I've never played a racing game on the N64 that used this system, and I kept pushing the B button instead. All this did was change the radio station, meaning that it would sometimes veer off the road while the music frantically changed. It was quite funny really, but I don't know why they were trying to rewrite the science of racing controls on the N64. All it did was initially confuse me. Some would call the handling of the cars jumpy, which is mostly true, but I would like to think it's intentional as a sad attempt at making the game somewhat original. It's a sad world when you can't figure out if it's deliberate or not, but be cautious as the thumbstick is super sensitive. This comes in handy sometimes, as there are certain kamikaze cars coming from the other direction, and being able to move out of the way at a split second's notice is quite convenient. Otherwise though, you don't really need to steer that much at all. The tracks are bendy for sure, but there are no steep turns until the later levels, where another problem rears its head. That is the braking system, which ultimately works too well. Just tapping a brake button slows you down too much, and you can't steer easily at all as you do so. It feels like the wheels just lock and refuse to turn at the same time. Instead of slowing down, you just end up stopping, but fly off the track at the same time. Over that, the physics are just terrible, even for a game of this age. When you drive over jumps for instance, you don't really fly like in comparable arcade races. You might as well have driven over a speed hump, or been a log drifting down a stream going over a slight hill. The hit detection also drove me bonkers, as even only slightly touching something spins you out of control. The twitchy steering somewhat helps that, but since I'm beginning to think that wasn't deliberate, then maybe that isn't such a good thing. All of this isn't helped by the fact that there is no map, but instead a radar. Yes, a radar in a racing game. What use is a radar when you're on a linear track, heading in only one direction? It's not like any other opponents are going to suddenly jump out of the bushes. This might be handy if there were a police presence in this game and you had to dodge them like in Road Rash, since street racing is illegal and all that, but not really. While there are actually police cars on the road, none of them pursue you. They obviously don't want to be a part of this sad excuse of an arcade port. So far, I've probably planted many negative thoughts about this game into your mind. So in that case, what did I like about this? Well, in the settings, you can change everything to the metric system. It's plain depressing that being able to see how fast I can go in case per hour excited me, since what does it really matter anyway, but I guess I was getting desperate. I guess the multiplayer was okay too, just because of the wackiness of the controls and the handling makes it somewhat interesting to show to a friend. But no doubt, deep hatred is going to set in after a few races, and you'll be scrambling to find your copy of Mario Kart 64 instead. Now while the resolution of the graphics and the frame rate isn't that fantastic, I do applaud the attention to detail thrown in, even if objects do appear to be made out of paper sometimes. America changes a lot as you travel across it, I've never done it myself of course, but popular culture says so, and pop culture is lore. It's interesting to see the changes as you drive across, that's probably the only real thing this game has going for it. There are also plenty of nice things thrown in like helicopters whizzing past, speeding trains, and aeroplanes landing in the background, giving some substance to the worlds. The music on the other hand though, absolutely shit me. Never have I encountered something so basic and devoid of rhythm while also being so weird at the same time. It sounds like a 15-year-old has been using GarageBand for the first time, and even his own mother is telling him to try again. I can't remember if it's the same music that's used in the arcade version, but then again that restaurant played 1950s hits non-stop anyway, so all that comes to mind is Buddy Holly when I think of that place.
So there you have it, my childhood ruined. Honestly, I did not expect this to be such a negative review. Even after I played it, it only added up that I liked nearly nothing about this game as I was writing the script. Funnily enough, I googled Jimmy Dean's and I found a photo of the exact arcade machine from my childhood. You'll find anything on that search engine, and it's cool to have a photo to look back to. For all I know though, the arcade version could have been terrible as well. Playing it as a child may have meant that I wasn't able to form a proper opinion over it, especially when I didn't have anything to compare it to. All I know is that Nintendo censored all the animals you can run over, which may or may not have been a deciding factor. Either way, I can say that the magic hasn't been replicated playing the N64 version. You might enjoy it more if you've never played it, but for me, it's ruined. Tread with caution.
Hello retro gamers, and thanks for watching. If you like what you just saw, then please consider helping out the show with a subscription. I release a new video every week. Also run a Twitter and a Facebook for good measure. Check out links for those in the description. There's also my own blog, where in separate posts I've delved into some Japanese Super Famicom and PS1 imports. There are also some links to my two previous videos, but that is all for today. Thank you again for watching, and I'll catch you next time.